Thank you for auditing Professor Skye's record review, the always positive new music review show hosted by a French professor who is an actual professor of French. And in my job, I have a class that I teach that is all about the history of French rock and roll and hip hop. And for a class on Friday, I'm having the students watch a presentation that I've made all about what is French hip hop right now in December 2020. As opposed to being in some kind of abstract history of the movement, I try to take it up to this exact moment. So I thought, why not share this with my auditors? Why not share this with YouTube? So if you hear me reference things that have happened in the past in the class, I don't do it too much, but that's what this is. This is the actual lesson that they're getting. So I hope you enjoy. Please leave comments. I am going to include a link to a playlist on YouTube that I have made that has all of the songs that I play. I can only play 10 seconds of each song because I'm scared to death of the copyright demons. So you'll be able to hear the songs a little bit, but if you want to hear more, some of them are quite good. Some of them really aren't, and we'll get into that when we watch the video. And also, if you are a French person, or if you know a lot about the current state of French hip-hop, please leave me comments. Let me know what you think. What did I miss? What is in the underground that I'm not seeing because my access is so limited, okay? I want to know more. Okay, so let's get on to the video. Let's get on to the class. French rock and hip-hop. Good morning. So today we're going to be talking about the fact that rap in France is very much alive, and we're going to get to what is happening right now. Now you might be wondering, you know, why haven't we talked about this more already? Well, it's a very difficult issue. I mean, this has been a class about the history of rock and hip-hop, and I've been very careful to make sure that as we've gone along, we've gone through the 80s and up into the heyday of the glory years of French hip hop in the late 90s. I even touched on the change to the 2000s and how commercialism and a sort of fake gangsterism started to appear all over French hip hop. But then when we get to the most recent decade and the 2000 and 2020, the year we're in now, I've kind of left you out to dry. I haven't really told you much. And there've been a lot of reasons for this. One of the primary reasons is my own ignorance. I mean, I started teaching this class in 2011, and at the time that I started it, I had all the relevant information. But as time has gone on, I've tried to keep up. When I try and keep up, I've just sort of ended up sort of being dismissive in not a very helpful way. The thing I remember saying all the way back in 2012 is, there's a lot more people saying a lot less. It's not like in the old days with NTM and IM making their albums that were important and changing the world. It's all just a bunch of substanceless, soft, singy, garbage music. It's no longer any good. Yada, 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 dismiss, dismiss, dismiss. But this is not honoring the true meaning of this class, which is to emphasize the concept that music reflects life. You can understand a society by understanding its music. So let's try to get to what is actually happening now in French hip hop. I was asked by someone at one point, a student stayed after class and asked me, so like, what's happening now? You know, which is a very good question, a very understandable question. So I'm gonna be moving my little screen around all over the place, Commander Zod. So what is happening now? So I decided to answer that with a meme. And as always, when an old professor makes a meme, it's going to be painful. So I apologize. But I was trying to think, you know, whenever people ask a French professor, you know, asking a French professor, what's happening right now in France, right? What's happening right now in France when you live in Western New York? Basically, what I said to the student is what I said before I prepared today's lesson. I have no idea what's going on. I just don't know. I don't live there. I don't know. But fortunately, there are ways to find out. And this is part of what I want to do and what I want to encourage in you, my students, is to have this kind of curiosity. Thanks to technology, we can find out all these answers. And the way that we're going to do that is by, first of all, making sure that we understand that rap is alive. And we're going to study a particular radio station that is a radio station of all hip hop in France. It's called Génération Hip Hop Soul Radio. And if you want to listen to French rap right now, you can go to this generations.fr and listen to their music. They have streaming French hip hop, American hip hop, world hip hop all the time. And this is sort of the best way to get a sense of what is the mainstream of hip hop music right now. This is what I've done every year for the past 10 years. This is what's led me to be an old man and saying, it's no good anymore. I am. Now there were some good beat makers. let's actually take some time here and really focus on what is actually happening. We are going to be studying the top 10, well, actually the top nine, I skipped the 10th one, the top nine musicians for the week of November 30th, 2020. That is last week. These are the most recent charts I could possibly get. I looked at the charts. I looked at all 10 musicians who were there, and I analyzed them. I studied them. I did research, and I put them into a larger context, both in terms of French history, in terms of French hip hop, and I'm going to present that to you now. As far as how this factors into the exam, I would say the main thing to take away is what are the attributes of hip hop in France right now? And like any good sort of lecture, I'm going to tell you it about three times. So you should know by the end here, but I'm going to be giving you a lot of examples. So speaking of dismissing French hip hop, I had you read something for today's class. And what I had you read was an amazing article from The Guardian, okay, written by Michael Oliver, "You're Not Welcome, Rap's Racial Divide in France." And it's this entire article written in April 2020, so not that long ago, about the way that many centralized forces of power, many centralized forces in France are actively trying to re-marginalize hip-hop. Hip-hop, which started in the margins, which represents the people who live at the margins of society, these centralized groups of cultural watchdogs and gatekeepers are actively trying to push hip hop out. But much like hip hop does in America, hip hop doesn't care what you try to do to it. It is going to keep going and eat everything until it is the dominant source of culture in the entire world. That's just what hip hop has been able to do. It might stop someday. I have a hard time seeing it stop. So what I want to do now is just kind of go over that article a little bit, kind of hit the highlights of it, because it shows this weird kind of bizarre divide that we have, where rap is amazingly popular. The people that it represents are amazingly important and historically marginalized in society. Yet we have a society that is not willing to embrace it. Despite the fact that it is French and it is successful, it is not seen as French enough for its success to merit recognition. So, what did we learn in this article? Well, one thing we learned about was Les Victoires de la Musique in 2020. Now, Les Victoires de la Musique, as I told you in the question packet, is basically like the Grammys in France. He talks a lot about the Brits, which is basically the Grammys in England. And as you read, Les Victoires are controlled by le Ministère de la Culture. Okay, the absolute most central of all central forces in French culture. These are the people who give the stamps of approval, who determine what is French culture. These are the people who make those decisions. And as you read, their decisions are insane. When we consider the fact, if we look at the total number of number one singles in France in 2020, as an example, the total number of number one singles in France was 19, okay? 19 different songs have been at the top of the French charts this year so far. There's only about a month left, okay? Total number of number one rap singles in France in 2020. And I should make this precise, French rap singles in 2020. That's 16. The most number one rap singles in a year in America isn't even close. It was 8, okay? So going by this metric, hip hop is twice as popular in France as it is in America. That's 16 out of 19 weeks. I mean, 16 out of 19 number one singles are French rap. That's for this year. I'd like to mention those other 3 weeks, it was a song by The Weeknd, a Canadian R&B singer who's very close to hip hop as well. Going even further, 31 out of 52 weeks this year, last year, the French album was at the top of the charts. French rap album was at the top of the charts. So more than half of the year, not just singles, but albums as well. It is an amazingly huge force in French culture. And as we will learn, what it represents is more than just music. It's also social identity. It's also immigration, integration. Okay, it's all these amazing things that it's always represented. This whole class, we've talked and talked and talked about the way that hip hop is the voice of the voiceless and the voice of the marginalized. That's still going, except now it is king. It is queen. Well, they behead kings in France. It is the chief, it is the leader in the music of France. And yet, for the French Grammys, none of France's Black or Arab rappers were nominated in an album, artist, or song category. Okay? So if we think about how extraordinarily successful these musicians are, to not be recognized by the Minister of Culture at all. Now, there used to be a category for hip hop. There isn't anymore. There's no category for hip hop anymore. Isn't that astounding? There were a couple people who are considered rappers who were nominated for other categories. One of them was nominated by the fans, so that's not getting the approval of the French state. And then the other two are these two guys. Now, you've been taking this class for a while. You know that white French rappers exist, and there are a lot of great white French rappers. But part of what makes French rap interesting is its mixture of different races. These were the two who were nominated, and they were both white rappers. As the article explained, this shows this kind of divide. And what was fascinating about the way the article was written is that it made it clear that the rappers and the people in hip hop society, they just know. Like, they're not even mad anymore. They're just expecting it. They just know it's going to come. They know they're going to be forgotten. As a quick reminder, you know, the Grammys suck, okay? Everyone knows the Grammys suck, but at least the Grammys are trying, okay? They came up with an entire category, Best Melodic Rap Performance. Now, the main reason that I've kind of dismissed French hip hop over the last decade or so is that it's too melodic. I don't like that much singing in my rap music. And so that's part of the reason why hip hop in America has become a little bit aggravating for me as well. But in America, we can recognize that, okay, instead of trying to make everything pure and centralized and what is the best one thing, you can break it into pieces. And that way, DaBaby can get a Grammy the same year that Benny the Butcher gets a Grammy. I don't think he was nominated. The Grammys suck, but still, it's an interesting idea. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say suck in class. The Grammys are subpar, suboptimal. Now, along with this, in that article, it explained another one of these centralizing forces in French hip hop, in French music, the Syndicat National de l'Édition Phonographique. This is essentially like the RIAA in America. This is the centralized group that keeps track of album sales and acts as like a lobbying group on behalf of musicians all throughout France. And they have made very conscious efforts to minimalize and reject hip hop throughout the years, okay? Let's look at some examples. In the article, one of the people who represents SNEP, which is pens backwards, calls hip hop an overexposed phenomenon. And what's interesting is over the years, they've changed the way that they categorize what's the top album by either removing entirely or reducing the weight of streams. So what's the main way people listen to music? Streams. What's the main way people listen to hip hop? Streams. So this is a very clearly conscious decision to try to make hip hop die. Like, just go away, would you? We need to have La Chanson Française. We need to have Jacques Brel, which we do need. But he's not coming back. He's Belgian anyway, it doesn't matter. We need this history. We can't just have this hip hop. In 2020, 44 out of the 48 months, weeks, I probably meant to say, a French rap song's been at the top of the charts. Okay, so that begs the question, what is at the top of the charts now? Am I actually going to talk about music at any point today? Yes, I am. Well, we're not going to start with the SNEP. No, thank you, SNEP. That is an ixnay on the nepse, okay? We're not going to start with them. We're going to finish with them. I am going to tell you what song is at the top of the charts now. You might be wondering, what genre is it? You might be having a suspicion of what genre it is, okay? So, what is at the top of the charts right now? We're not going to focus on that. Instead, I'm going to give you a little history lesson. I'm going to go through the history of French hip hop of the last 12 years and 20 years even. And I'm going to do it in a way in which we go through the music that we're listening to. We're going to go through this top 10 list from Génération Hip Hop Soul Radio. Okay? We're going to go through each of them. Now, if we look at these lists, right, what's pretty striking is this is not a French rap list. This is just a rap list. And these are the songs that are at the top of the list. A French song, an American song. A French song, an American song. A French song, You probably know how this is going. A French song, a French song, a French song, a French song, a French song. Okay? That's how things have been going, and that's how it is. It is one of the few areas in popular culture in which the French language is a benefit as opposed to a detractor in its consumption by the youth and by the French populace. Okay? It's a way that French culture has managed to really stay relevant and become globally important because of the importance of French hip hop. But we've already talked about that so much in class. It's not coffee, it's water. I keep water in my coffee jar, and that way it always tastes a little bit like coffee. Not so good. So let's start at the beginning, okay? And we're gonna be studying modern French rap. And if you have your notebooks, this will be the first time you write this down. You are gonna have to send me a scan of your notes for today. So make sure you take some interesting notes. Feel free to pause it if you need to. So modern French rap is much more pop than rap, at least in the mainstream, at least in the charts. It sounds a lot more poppy than it sounded the way we like, where, and part of the reason why is that they're singing everywhere and melody everywhere. And if I could give I'm grabbing my thing that advances slides, so it goes a little bit slicker. There's melody everywhere. And I would say, actually, it's one thing that the French do better than America does. And that's just from forcing myself the last couple of weeks to really listen to modern popular French hip hop. Because for the last 10 years, when I've been trying to do this, I hear a song and I hear an auto tuner, or I hear someone singing and I just go skip. But it's amazing how they have mixed together these melodies with hip hop. They do it astoundingly well. And I think it goes beyond just imitating America and is part of what makes French hip hop right now unique. Now, I would say it's uniquely bad in that way, or that way is a way it's unique that I don't like. But still, it's interesting because it's at least different. It's often quite soft. There are some hard songs that follow kind of a trap beat. Oh, okay. That was weird. My computer just decided to stop working. But this appears to be still recording. So, good. I feel good about that. All right. So there's themes of materialism and wealth. As I discussed when I talked about right-wing rap, there was a turn in France right around the turn of the century, around 2002, where rap became very materialistic, not as political. And this, as I said, is kind of a sad development. It is a very sad development, actually, I'd say, because French hip hop stayed so politically active, socially conscious, it's moved away towards simple capitalism and sometimes even hyper-capitalism. However, very importantly, they are still very connected to the suburbs. And just to reemphasize, the suburbs are where most of the immigrants who moved to France live, in mostly HLM, which is the word for the projects. And this is where a lot of people have felt forgotten and marginalized by society, okay? Not like American suburbs. And so they're still very connected to the suburbs. The one thing French hip hop has always done has been to impose the existence of those in the suburbs. And the one thing it still does is it imposes its existence, like my dog is imposing its existence to the people outside. Woof, woof, we exist, okay? And still connected to Africa. Still connected to the first, second generation rappers who make this music, who are for the most part all from different parts of Africa or their families are, okay? So some things have changed and some things have stayed the same. So let's actually get to it. Let's go through track by track here, okay? Let's listen to all the French, I'm not gonna listen to that Justin Bieber song with you. I'm sure there's actually a lot of interesting things to be said about that song. I'm not gonna say them, so I apologize. I'm not that yummy. Okay, so let's move on to the first track, Dieu Merci by Dadju. Okay, already right there with his name, you can hear a very African influence. And I'm gonna play you 10 seconds of each of these songs. Okay, I'm gonna be posting this, and I think if it's over 10 seconds, there's gonna be some copyright issues. But I think in these 10 seconds, you'll be able to hear exactly what I'm saying. You'll be able to hear the sing-songy nature, the softness, the themes of wealth and accrual of wealth, also the connection to Africa as well. It all kind of comes in here in this very melodic pop form of R&B hip-hop that is dominating not only the charts in the hip-hop charts, the urban charts, but also the mainstream charts. So let's have a listen first to this song, Dieu Merci, which means Thank God, by Dadju. Okay, so here in this song, I didn't share computer sound. In this song, he talks about how he's going to leave street life, but then invest in Africa just so quickly. And he just says right here, like, we're leaving the street life. And it's this theme of breaking out of the poverty. And you heard the singing. And then the next line, I gave my first checks to my aunts, Western Union, money transfer to Congo. This is very much a part of the French experience for those who don't come from France, wherever they come from, sending money back home. I changed my clothes, Louis Vuitton, Gucci, in order to feel handsome. I used to dream about it since I was a kid, so I got a Mercedes, etc. Okay, so it seems material wealth, but there's still this kind of interesting sadness, a sort of mourning of, not necessarily mourning, but like this idea that like they've come from nothing and they're still very connected to that state. They're bragging, they're talking about Louis Vuitton and Gucci, but they're saying in order to feel handsome. There is a certain amount of self-awareness in this song, which I think does exist in American rap. I think it's a little bit more self-aware than a lot of similar pop rappers are now in America. So this is Dadju, and he's sort of a typical pop rap singer, and he's very much in the mold of somebody else. Now, I am the youngest of four, so I know what it's like to be a younger brother, but this guy is such a younger brother because he is the younger brother of probably the most influential person we're going to be discussing today, Gims, okay? The person who's basically, not single-handedly, but almost single-handedly defined this wave of pop and rap and singing and all together. So let's take a hop off of the top nine of French rap and get into a little bit of the influences. How did we get here? Artists like Dadju and these other artists we're going to be studying, like Zola. Okay, let's take a little bit of time to study Gims. Okay, G-I-M-S, Maître Gims, whose real first name is Gandhi. That's true. He's an interesting character. He's Congolese. Now, from the Democratic Republic of Congo. So that was the former Belgian. The former Belgian colony. It's interesting, we're gonna see a preponderance of people from here. And in the past in French hip hop, we see a preponderance of people from former French colonies, you know, like Senegal or Algeria. So this does appear to be one change, and I'm not quite sure why this change has happened. I mean, certainly they're all Francophone countries anyways, and there's also some linguistic similarities between Democratic Republic of Congo and the Congo that was colonized by the French, the Republic of Congo. But anyways, so he's from a Congolese family. His father was actually a famous musician, but then he moved to France. He grew up on the outskirts of Paris. Much like all the people that we've studied, he lived a sort of tough life on the outskirts of society, a small criminal. And then he learns how to rap. And when he starts, he's a rapper, and he's a really, really, really talented rapper, like, you know, top five French MCs, that kind of rapper. But then he does something else. He's a real singer. Like, he can really sing. Like, he's not, you know, he's not a 4A singer, right? He's not good 4A rapper. He is just a good singer. So his sort of singular ability to do both these things, and I can't think of anybody in the history of hip hop who is a great actual singer and a great rapper. Let me know if you can think of anybody who is great at both of those. Now, unfortunately, he still uses a lot of auto-tune, which I don't quite understand, but he's able to mix these together. And through this, he changed French hip hop. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm just gonna play you a little bit of Gims, just a bit, so you get a sense. I'm gonna play you an album of his. Now, he sort of came up in 2012. That was sort of when he started to rise to power. He's still very relevant. When he's going to release an album today. Jesus, today. I'll just review that. Why not? He's going to be releasing an album today, and that's going to be number one, and that's going to be huge, right? He's still very relevant. But we're going to also, what's interesting is he managed to play
the Stade de France, you know, the famous stadium where France won the World Cup in 1998. And it is like, you know, a 90,000 seat soccer arena, and he sold it out. Okay. Other artists who have done this, Johnny Halliday. Okay. Like, that's about it. So if you want further proof of how dominant hip hop is, we see it here. And in the event this interests you at all, and if you have a Netflix subscription, there is an entire documentary about Geems. He's a fascinating person. He seems like he's a fairly authentic person with a very interesting life. If you watch it and give like a short summary of it, I'll give you extra credit. I was going to assign it, but I don't want to force people to like subscribe to Netflix for my class. So I don't really know. But it's very interesting because it shows his development and how did he become this transformational figure? How did he completely change hip hop in his image? Okay, so let's hear some tracks off of his album, Ceinture Noire, Black Belt, right? And we're going to listen to it and we're going to hear those kind of different sides. And he's very into these two different sides, the singer and the rapper. And so first we're going to start off with his just straight pop, the song La Même, the same, okay? So let's listen to this a little bit. I'm going to put these lyrics up here. Doesn't even really matter. It's too complicated. I'll never choose just the two sides. But it's all about these two different sides within him. But listen how this guy is really singing and how soon we're going to hear him really rapping.
Je suis trop compliqué, je choisirai jamais que les deux côtés. Ne me demandez pas où je veux aller.
And if you watch that documentary, you'll see him singing and you'll see him like an actual like voice lesson, and you can really hear his talent. Another thing that they emphasize in that movie and that he emphasizes himself is that he's a very, very strong rapper. He doesn't rap very much. It's actually quite frustrating to me because he's so, let's see. That got dramatic. What's that? I swallowed a bug. So, he is a very, very strong rapper. And what he does is he sort of, the way he uses rap is just to show people, I can still do it. I've still got it, right? So we're going to hear a song where he had another rapper, Sofiane, on with him. And his goal was pretty clear. He was going to kill Sofiane. Like there was going to be a rap and he was going to come on. And even though he's Mr. Pop Singer and he's got his famous sunglasses that he never takes off and he's this image of a pop star, he can still rap. So listen to this rap. It's 10 seconds. It's like 47, it's like 1,000 words in 10 seconds. Listen to the way he raps super fast and then slows down. It gets kind of sing-songy and then comes back. He's able to play with rhythm. He's able to play with his cadence. He's a very powerful rapper. And I think these two things are why he was able to take over. Because if you were from the street and you wanted to listen to hip hop, Geems worked for you. If you were just at a Sephora trying to buy makeup and his music is on the radio, you kind of go, okay, right? It all kind of matches together. So let's listen to a little bit of this song. I wish I could play more of this for you. It is really quite something.
Je veux te casser les phalanges, tu verras comment c'est marrant. Je suis collé comme un étalon, le baron daron des darons. Est-ce que tu me suis? Viens, on parle sur WhatsApp. Je suis sur écoute, mieux vaut chuchoter. Le manager anti.
Okay, it just goes on. Like, see, do you hear I kind of like slowed down and then went a little bit further? And all the time, even though he's becoming like, even though he's showing off, he could be a real rapper, it's still lyrical and it's still musical. And it's this combination that makes him so interesting and what made him such a transformational force. Also, he's very much into suburban pride, like the pride of being from the French suburbs. And he's also very proud of his African roots. He goes back, he plays concerts in Africa. He even has a song in Lingala, which if you don't know Lingala is a language spoken by some of the Bantu in both the Democratic Republic of Congo and the Congo, right? So he actually is able to rap and show a certain pride in his African origins. And he's even recently been integrating more African sounds into his rap. Now, I've given an entire lesson all about the nature of French hip hop and how they use African sounds. That's definitely gone down, or it was sort of dipping in the early 2000s, but it's actually become a lot more in vogue to integrate more African rhythms and African sounds into this very sing-songy and pop rap. In that way, he was very influenced by someone who started a lot later than him, MHD. Now, you watched a Viceland documentary about MHD. You learned a little bit about him. I'm going to restate some of the things that you watched. But he was the one exception. In the last 10 years, I have bought one French rap album, and it was this guy's rap album, because he could actually rap, and he was doing stuff that wasn't just singing the whole time, right? So he's Ghanaian and Senegalese parents. He comes from the 19th arrondissement, which, as you know, is the same place where the Charlie Hebdo murderers came from. He's sort of rehabilitating and sort of changing this neighborhood. I've actually stayed in that neighborhood. It's fine. Yes, there's a lot of people there who aren't white, but it's actually, I never felt in any danger. A YouTube star, social media star. Again, this is kind of how music reflects life. He's very conscious of how to record his videos and release them on YouTube. And he created the Afro trap genre, which we are going to discuss. Again, going back to the same idea of musical style reflecting social identity, right? We've already studied that with Bladi by Freeman and Bisa Nabiso, but here we're going to see how it happens in a little bit of a different way. So how would I define Afro-trap? Well, Afro-trap is a mixture of the American style, like Atlanta-style trap music with the ricky-ticky hi-hat and the doom bass, right? Like, you know what trap sounds like because it's what everything sounds like now. And African music. The music is mixed in. The African rhythms, especially the kind of like... The dancing that you do to his music is not at all the same kind of dancing that you do to trap music. It's a lot more kind of upbeat, a lot of playful background voices, doing sort of like hip hop ad libs, but in more of an African style, almost like a mocking ad lib, like and very upbeat. So I'm just going to play you 10 seconds of this. The lyrics don't really matter here very much. What matters is that he has a good flow and he's rapping. Bro, give me my check. They gave me strength. I don't know failure anymore. And then in the back, you'll hear the great sort of teasing ad libber going, right in the background. And then he says, always starter, like get that check. Now that's a sports reference to a Parisian soccer player who's a popular national soccer player. Also of, I believe, Malian origin. Okay, so let's listen to this Afro trap, because this is from 2016. Okay, so this really helped to ensure that the African heritage of French hip hop was like resuscitated a little bit, and we hear it now in more music that we're going to be listening to soon.
File mon chèque, on m'a donné la soif, je connais plus l'échec. Je connais plus l'échec, toujours titulaire comme Keita chèque.
Okay, so I think if we were to look at French hip hop now, we could say that it's sort of a mixture of these two titans. Okay, it's a mixture of Guillaume and MHD. On the whole, it's more pop than rap. Singing is everywhere, melody is everywhere. It's often soft, but sometimes kind of trap. Themes of materialism and wealth in all of them, but still very connected to the suburbs, still very connected to the marginalized parts of society, and very connected to Africa. So that's how we got here. That's how we got to this top 10 list. That's how we got back here, where I just keep on throwing my head all over the place. That's how we got back here. So let's see if this is going to continue. Let's see if this trend is going to continue. So we'll skip Internet Money by, no, Lemonade by Internet Money. I don't know what that means. Still an old man. And we're going to go to Nino, Tout en Gucci, which I hope you understand means all in Gucci, right? So talking about the Italian clothing, right? Again, from the Democratic Republic of the Congo, grew up in the outskirts of Paris. He's a rapper and a pop artist, one of the most popular artists of the past decade. And this song we're going to hear is kind of mournful and interesting. It's all about being dressed up in Gucci. But as we see the lyrics, I'll dress myself all in Gucci. In front of the mirror, I find myself BG, which means bon genre, which sort of means like bougie in English, but not quite the same, to use American slang. Like, he sees himself in the mirror and he like doesn't relate to who he is because he doesn't think of himself as this kind of person. And then he talks about something else, a little bit embarrassed. He's embarrassed to be dressed so well. Embarrassed when his family asks him the price. So again, I've been talking about this sort of mournful tone, and we saw that in the first track, you know, where it's like, I got all this money, I'm going to send back to the Congo. and I'm all rich and I'm all fancy and fly. But how much did that cost? This t-shirt cost your entire salary last month. Yeah, I'm fine, right? So the kind of the wealth gap, the generations of poverty, of maltreatment, all kind of coming in this song, which if you just saw the title, you just go, oh, it's just about Gucci, you know, Gucci gang, but in French, Le Gang Gucci, right? No, it's actually its own thing. So let's have a listen once again, basically singing this. And again, this is a guy who can rap. His singing isn't that strong. There's some pretty strong auto-tuning here, but we can hear this.
Je m'habillerai tout en Gucci. Devant le miroir, je me trouve BG, un peu gêné quand la femme.
So, really, that's the kind of music which I would hear and I would just skip. Because they have dinner, et je m'habillerai tout en Gucci, tout en Gucci. Je me trouve BG, un peu gêné. I just hear that and just go, come on, rap, god damn it. But this is what's necessary. We need to understand that rap has changed. It has really changed. In France, it has really changed. And this is the way it has changed. The old days are dead. They're gone. But this new day has its own value. So let's keep listening to it and studying it. Next, we have Dudu by Aya Nakamura. Now, what's interesting about her, she has a Japanese name. She's actually, her family is from Mali. So she took the name from the character Hiro Nakamura from the TV show Heroes, which is kind of funny, kind of goofy, kind of nerdy. She sort of doesn't belong on this list, I would argue, because she's not really hip hop. Although the SNEP, as you read in that article, called her the voice of French rap, which she's not. She is the voice of French rap the way Rihanna is the voice of American rap. It's like, Rihanna wouldn't exist without hip hop the way that she is. She wouldn't present herself the way she does. She wouldn't sing the way she sings. She wouldn't have the popularity that she has, right? But she's not really a rap artist. That's kind of how Aya Nakamura is as well. But it's part of this interesting soup that we find ourselves in where all these genres start to mix together, pop, R&B, and hip hop. And there is a lot of crossover in Aya Nakamura's fan base and rap fan base. And so much of her experience is influenced by Africa rhythmically, you know, being from Mali. And there's a ton of influence from rap in her music as well. So we might as well keep her on the hip hop charts. And I'll just play you a little bit. She's an extremely popular singer, both sort of in the pop charts and in hip hop charts. And let's hear just an example of this song. I don't know. I tried to translate these lyrics. I didn't really do a great job with it. It doesn't really matter. Just hear how this is full singing, full kind of R&B, but still with some interesting rhythms happening in the background, a little bit more of that influence of the more rhythmically rich music of Africa. And also a little bit of the islands here as well, almost kind of Caribbean at times. So moving on past Nakamura, who almost doesn't belong on this list, but I think she does. We're going to the second page. This is the full page of all French rappers. And we're going to get some interesting things here. Let's talk about Koba LAD. Koba, I was like, hey, I wonder if he named himself after the character from Planet of the Apes. And he did. So that's cool. I like those Planet of the Apes movies. We see an image of him here. We're starting to see that some French rappers are taking on the trappings and the affect of American SoundCloud rappers, brightly colored hair, brightly colored clothes. They're starting to follow a little bit there. Never just assume that France is just following America. Sometimes it does, but it's usually doing something slightly different. It's rarely just a simple imitation. It's rarely just aping America. Get it? Koba? Okay. So let's study Koba here. Very similar story. He's from the Congo, but the Republic of the Congo, so the former French colony, not the former Belgian colony, grew up in the suburbs of Paris. Much like the rest of the French rappers you've been studying, it's over and over and over again with the same story. But again, it is essential to note, these are people who have been largely forgotten in French mainstream society. This is their primary visibility. And so however visible it is, however repetitive it might seem, each repetition is important. His style, he sort of raps about like dealing coke, and it's kind of like Booba did and Lafouine, kind of like fake drug trafficking stuff. Okay, it's fine. A mixture of trap and R&B. This song happens to be about search warrants. So apparently you can't serve a search warrant until 6 a.m. So he's like talking about being there. He references the Netflix show Narcos. His producer tag is Hadouken. It's kind of a thing about a lot of rappers, especially rappers who pretend to be criminals when they're not. They're just sort of nerds. So like there's a lot of like rap songs about, you know, The Wire and Narcos and The Sopranos. It's like, are you just watching TV? Are you just watching TV? Because that's not that's not how to be a criminal. Here's an interesting line from one of the guest rappers on here. Je suis Marocain, mais je suis né dans le pays de Louis. Which is an interesting line. I'm Moroccan, but I'm born in the country of Louis. And I realized he's probably talking about Louis Vuitton. He's probably not talking about Louis the 14th, which is just kind of funny because Louis the 14th is one of the most famous people in the history of civilization. But that's probably less important than Louis Vuitton. Well, of course, Louis the 14th set up the Black Code and really extended the slave trade in Africa. So, hip hop wouldn't have existed without it. So who knows? Maybe Louis the 14th is more important. So I'm just going to play you a little bit of this song. The lyrics again, the judge has me in his sights. Skirt, skirt, skirt. You know, the same kind of sounds that American rappers make. The cops are in front of the apartment at 6 o'clock. The judge has me in his sights. Again, just listen to the soundscape that's here. It's kind of like sad, kind of dark, sing-songy hip hop.
Là je suis pas dans le viseur. Ce que y'a les queues dans la porte à 6 heures. Là je suis pas dans le viseur.
I have to admit, I've listened to these songs, all 9 of these songs, like 10 times now. The first time I listened, I really didn't like them. But then I eventually kind of got around to really enjoying some of them. This is a good example. Like I hear it and just the part of me just goes, this is too pop. This is garbage. This is not hip hop. But it's just so well done. The melody is so nice. It's really well produced. So there is a lot to this that I ended up surprisingly liking. I'll move on to Slide, the most obnoxiously catchy song we're going to be studying. This is fun because it's very clearly trying to be a party anthem. I don't actually know where he's from. I believe he's from the Congo, but I don't know which one. He's from the suburbs of Paris. I don't know which one. That's the problem with doing this whole exercise. Do you know how hard it is to find information on some of these people? Some of them just popped up and like, we don't know, you know. So anyways, what's interesting about him is he was a hardcore rapper who turned into an actor who then turned into a pop rapper. So his original stuff is kind of hardcore trap, the stuff that I would like. And then he was on a TV show, and now he does pop music because he has a higher profile. This song is just about partying, smoking, and dope, and a really bad chorus, just a really painful chorus. But there's actually some pretty strong rapping. He has an interesting sort of personality. Like one point, the whole thing's about slide. He says, je slide, and slide is not a French word. Je slide, who's bad? He's actually quoting Michael Jackson. You'll hear it in this quote here. This little 10 seconds of it. But this is a great example of a song that's designed to be a hit. It is a hit. And it's, the kind of song where I could imagine it becoming everywhere. And then you just go, oh, I remember 2020. Remember the slide? Remember when we used to dance the slide?
Oui, je suis m'ambiancé. C'est vrai que t'es John, mais t'es pas fiancé. Joue au max sa mère qui t'a dans la pochette. Lunette sur le nez, je sais pas si t'as capté. Je slide, who's bad?
Just like, who's bad? I didn't even translate this term here, jambe. It's a new French rap term that means just a very attractive woman. I couldn't figure out the next line. Stacks in my pocket, I figured that out. But it is hard to translate a lot of these things. You've known all semester. I do my best, but I don't live in France. I live in Western New York. It's hard to figure out French slang from the 91 in Paris. So. But at least figure out what jom means. Moving on to La Crime. Now, I've actually studied La Crime a little bit. This song is called Boston George. It's not about anybody from Boston. It's about a famous drug dealer named Boston George. And Lacrim is finally our first rapper who is of Arab descent. Lacrim, Algerian origins from the outskirts of Paris, very much just a coke rapper and a trap rapper and R&B, all these things that I've been talking about. This whole trend that has started and has reached its heights with Geems. Just what is a rapper anymore? A rapper is a singer. A singer is a rapper. Very gravelly voice. You know, we've studied how the French language is infused with English and slang and the language of the home country, the language of the bled. That's what that bled means, the home country. And his a great example, because he just throws in Arabic words here and there, which ensures that the audience has to be bilingual to fully understand what he means. There's sort of somewhat inexplicable Latin rhythms, and I'd say this is throughout all of this top 10 list and top 20 list. It seems as though the sort of global trend towards playing beats that sound like they come from South America, kind of Latin rhythms, have transferred into the French hip hop mainstream. And it's kind of a weird case of something popular sidestepping America, right? I mean, I guess there's Despacito, but this was happening even before Despacito. So like, there's this real Spanish influence and it's just whatever's popular. So we're gonna hear that a little bit in here as well. There's an interesting line in here from the guest appearance. There's a guy on here who sings, "J'ai grandi en France, mais je vis ailleurs et je vais mourir au bled." I am out of water. I grew up in France. I live outside of it. I'm going to die in my home country. This constant sense, this sense that we need to be connected to our home countries. So the lyrics here, again, don't matter too much. He's just sort of talking about being in police custody and being arrested. We're just going to get a sense of this before our final song.
On a trop souffert, le regard en dit long, je suis dans la GAV, j'aimerais juste fumer un pilon, le bon fait.
Okay, which now leads us to my favorite singer on this whole list, my favorite rapper on this whole list. I'm probably going to really focus on his most recent album and listen to it and buy it. There's a couple reasons why. This is the artist known as Zola. Now, as you may or may not remember, I named my daughter Zola. I named my daughter Zola after the writer Emile Zola. But what's funny is this guy, his last name is Zola. So it's not even a reference to the great historical figure in France. It's just, you know, he, a Congolese again, grew up in the suburbs of Paris in the 91. That's the postal code of the suburb. And his last name happened to be Zola. So that's why he goes as Zola. So it's kind of funny. It's just, I really enjoy that he has a name of a great French pillar of society and culture, but it's completely separate from it, right? Isn't that what's great about studying culture? That you can read an amazing piece of literature, you can study the Dreyfus Affair and go back in history and have this really deep connection. And then you can also study something that seems as silly and as ephemeral as a popular hit, a rap song in December 4th, 2020. So he's very much more kind of hardcore. He integrates a lot more electronic dance music elements, as we'll hear in this clip. He has an interesting flow. I think he's a lot more in the mode of MHD, of really trying to be a rapper first and a pop singer more. But still, there's a hook chorus, which I'm not going to play for you because I'm going to play some of his rapping. He has a great line, "Le fantôme est malgaré sur les champs." So he's talking about his Rolls Royce is parked badly on the Champs-Élysées, which is just a kind of fun way of talking about your wealth. And it's actually with SCH, who is a rapper from Marseille. And you'll notice that this station is a Parisian station. So everything we've been watching is Parisian. I imagine if the station were from Marseille, we'd have more representation from Marseille. But here you go, we work with what we have. So the lyrics that you're gonna hear here, I wasn't able to translate some of them. I don't know what schwa means. He talks about les profs, which means teachers, professors like me, but I'm not sure why. I know poucave means rats. Les baltringues is a very complicated word for idiots out on the streets. Makes it that Paris is hell for the better. I cross my fingers, you get ripped off like you fell asleep at the fire. I did my best, but really what matters here is hearing this flow, hearing the electronic dance music, the interesting rhythms, and the sort of current state of sort of rapping for rap's sake in French rap.
Ni les profs, les boucaves, les baltringues dans nos rues, toute cette merde, ça fait qu'un banal, c'est l'enfer en mieux. Je croise les doigts pour les miens. Tu te fais arracher ton sac comme tu te fais endormir ton feu. Les rapports se passent au volant, tu passes.
Yeah, that's just a great track. I really suggest looking for that track if you can. It's called 9113, and that's a direct reference to the suburb where he's from, 91, and then the area code of Marseille, which is 13. So it's about this connection between Marseille and Paris, which, as you know, is quite important in French hip hop. So that brings us to this question. What is at the top of the Snap charts now? You want to take a guess? Do you think I had you listen to it recently? Well, why did I stop at 9? Why did I not go to number 10? Because it was too interesting to see that the number 9 on the Generations chart is the number 1 on the French charts. For the entire country, that song that we just heard was the number 1 song in the country. French hip hop refuses to die. It is very alive. And I'm happy that my favorite song of all these songs, right? Because this was an interesting challenge to me. Because all of these songs, if I heard them in a car, I would change the station on first listen, okay? This has been a chance to really give it a chance and really see what is it that makes these popular and what is it that makes them good. And I've learned that this particular genius that French hip hop has now for mixing R&B and hip hop really is impressive, even if it's not what I personally like. So what are the conclusions that we can take here as we look at Zola burning a 100-year-old bill in some kind of bathroom? I don't really know where he is there. What kind of conclusions can we take away from this? Well, I told you I'd be repeating myself. French hip hop today is driven by melody. It is a blend of hip hop and R&B. Singing or auto-tuning is omnipresent. It is everywhere. Themes of material wealth and trap beats are also everywhere. There are some remnants of African themes and African music. Maybe not as strong as we heard in the past, but their presence does matter. They're still very strongly banlieusard, which is to say suburban. Suburban identity is extremely important. And finally, let's just state it right out. Representation matters. You know, you've read these articles, you've read about the history of France, you've read about France since the 70s and the importance of hip hop. You know, I made that little chart, but it wasn't really accurate, was it? Right? I mean, who do these people actually represent? You know, the song Dadju is French, but it has two people from the Democratic Republic of Congo. Nino has one. Aya Nakamura is someone who has origins in Mali. All these people who live in France and who feel marginalized have a voice at the very top of the culture. Koba is from the Republic of Congo, and he has someone sing on there who's from Morocco. Barsh is from probably Democratic Republic of Congo, Lacrim, Algeria, singing with someone from Morocco. Zola, interestingly enough, he's singing with somebody from Marseille whose origins are German. It isn't all about race, right? It's also about all sorts of immigrants and all sorts of what is it to be French? And that is still the number one question in French hip hop, is how do people be French? How does French culture change? And how does French hip hop take French culture and move it to become more inclusive and to express more of the reality of the country as it is today? It's all French and it's all more. So there you go. There's the class lesson. As I said, I'd like you to just look up one of the songs that's on that list and write me a short description of what you feel about listening to it, and make sure to send me your class notes. And until class on Monday, there's the camera.